Good morning.
Good morning.
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Amen. You just forgot. I thought I could get some car. Good to see you all this morning. Welcome. You too this morning. It's Easter morning, Resurrection Sunday, and we are here. We're going to open with our worship team and our opening hymns. So if you would prepare your hearts, stand, and join together.
Rise, shine.
start an Easter service, huh? That was great. Don't come back every week to do this. We're here at 9 o'clock. Am I on?
Yeah.
Okay. The announcements are in the bulletin. I want to keep it brief. No Sunday school today, no youth today. Just go and celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ with your friends and family. April 19th, 3:45, Bible study, trustees meeting Wednesday, and Thursday is the ad board meeting. There are a few other announcements in there I wish you would give your attention to. We are still supporting Jackson Breedlove family for his upcoming surgery this Thursday. You can make a check payable to the Florida United Methodist Church in the memo Jackson Breedlove Fund. Help the folks out, the family, when there's going to be a lot of traveling and gas and food expenses when they're down there as Jackson recovers from his surgery. That's another way we can support my buddy down there. And Coca-Cola Rescue Mission, Sunday is April 30th. And read that and donate, please, generously. Are there any other announcements that need to be lifted up this morning? Yes.
I just have one quick one. Community meal, I know it's Easter Sunday, but it's hyped up. It will be on the back table. It is a nacho bar, and it is April 25th, I think. It's that front, that last Tuesday. Please sign up.
Gotcha. Any others? We have a few birthdays and anniversaries here that we're going to celebrate. 17th is Bart Johnson. 18th is Dave Bordner. Happy birthday, Dave, coming up there. 19th, Scott Silverthorne. 21st, Jennifer Newcaster. 22nd, Erica Soros, Shana Ruppert, and Maxine Shanks. Any other birthdays? Anybody have one today or anything you want to celebrate? Anniversaries, I don't see any. Anybody have one? Welcome back our snowbirds and some of our travelers. The Wagoners are back, Shirley and Gordon, and Dick and Betty Smith are back. They were back last week, but I don't want you to miss Dick. He's here this week too, so. Any other announcements for the good of the community? Then we will worship God with our tithes and offerings, and you will pray and think about Resurrection Sunday. Just an amazing gift we've been given, and God gives us generously, and we appreciate all of your support that goes to the ministries of this church and outreach to the community. If the ushers would come forward at this time. Father God, we just thank you for your abundant blessings, and we are reminded today of the enormous gifts you've given us, and especially the gift of everlasting life through your Son, Jesus Christ, who endured the cross, overcame death, and rose again. May we rise again and be your people. Use these gifts for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen. May you be seated. Always straight and kids having a Holy Spirit moment here. That's the way you're supposed to all feel. Come down and run around in the aisle. You want to try it?
I don't.
It's time to just pray, get it together, and lift our prayers up. I ask for your attention to the prayer list. In your bulletin, Jackson, you were going to come down there with a prayer over you, and then Eden asked for prayer for Jackson to get well. Mindy's praying for Kenny Davis. Mindy Thompson asked for prayer for Kenny Davis. 11. Kiara Phillips, 9. Kyra McDonald, 7. Tiny Wells, 5. Yes. Where are you? There you are. Good prayer, good reminder. Pray for the family. The house stands across the street. A reminder of just what a promise Jesus Christ overcoming death for resurrection through that. Those precious ones have that today, yes. Thank you for that. Please give attention to the prayer list that's in your bulletin. Pray for all of these folks. The family of George Baker Sr., Jerry Albaugh, family in Jerry's passing, Ernest Pitts, Albert, Amber Moreno, Zach Hoskins, Fallon, Sansing, Michael West, and Michael, I think, is doing better, isn't he? And we have several others, so keep these all. I'm not going to go through them all, but they are in our heart. I saw Amos this week. He's doing great. He said, thank you for your prayers. Keep praying. And he is, believe me, keeping all his therapists on their toes. Dave Bordner is having surgery this week, I understand, on his shoulder. He's looking at me like, how do you know that? I'm going to tell him. But I pray for Dave and the surgery and the recovery. But even more, some family members asked for prayer. The girls are going to have to do all the chores, take care of the house, do everything. And Wendy, and I'm sure he's just going to be so pleasant and relaxed around the house, so because he likes sitting around doing nothing. So we're praying for you, my friend, and for your family. Girls, we've got a blanket of prayer over you. I'm sorry. If you want to call the office, we'll see if we can get people to come help you, since your dad is so brutal to you. Any other prayers that need to be lifted up this morning? Maybe you didn't write them down, but you just thought of them. I pray for everyone who's unable to be here today. And for those who are traveling, for safe travel mercies. Lots of prayers. Thank you for you, Chuck, and every week what you do for us and share your gifts for the choir, for those who run the sound and the projectors. A lot of gratitude for all of you. Yes. Kairos this week coming to the facility. May lives be changed for that. We're praying. Praying for them for all of that. Jackson, you want to come down and pray with me, bud? You're looking awful sharp. Isn't he? Surgery Thursday. You doing all right? Yeah? Anything special you want people to pray? And it gets through it fast and has a quick recovery with his heart surgery. He's counting on the prayers. They give him a lot of strength. So we are going to do this. Not a problem, right? Amen. Let's pray together. Gracious God, we just thank you for the beautiful gift we received today. We thank you that we can come before you and lift our prayers. In times when we're fearful and we are unsure of the future, Lord, give us that peace that passes understanding to trust you in each and and every event of our life. Lead us and guide us, gracious God. Lift up Jackson, and I know you already have blessed him and are with him, but we ask an extra special blessing on him, the doctors and nurses, and we pray for a speedy recovery that won't surprise even Jackson. We pray for mom and dad and the entire family and all who gathered together to help support and lift Jackson up. We're going to look forward to celebrating with him when he's all better and back with us again. So once again, we thank you for hearing our prayers, Lord. We thank you in Jesus' name, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power,
Easter egg hunt. Yeah, a lot of you went last Saturday. I saw you and liked it. When a mother hen sits on her eggs for a few weeks, do you know what happens? Right, the eggs crack open and a little baby chick comes out. So an egg means new life. It reminds us that there is a new life inside that can come out. We celebrate Easter Sunday because that is the day that Jesus came out of the egg. A tomb, but man, that's really super cool. But he comes out of the tomb, but it's like cracking an egg and something new life comes out. I love it. So this morning I have brought what I call a real Easter egg. Show you why I call it a real Easter egg. Emmalyn, be very gentle with my egg. And Holden, can I trust you? Be really careful with my egg. Okay, so this is the real Easter egg. And I want everybody to turn where they can see these kiddos. It reminds me that on Easter Sunday, when Jesus' followers went to his tomb, the tomb was empty. An angel was there to tell them, he is not here, he has risen. Just as he said, the grave is empty. Jesus isn't in there. He's alive. And because Jesus is alive, we have new life in him. Okay, let's see if Jesus is in the egg, Holden. Crack it. Crack it. Crack it. Oh. Where's Jesus? Okay, let's check yours, Emily. Jesus, are you in there?
Thank you.
scripture this morning is from Matthew chapter 28, verses 1 through 20. Matthew's account of the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Listen and follow as you choose. After the Sabbath, at dawn on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went to look at the tomb. There was a violent earthquake, for the angel of the Lord came down from heaven, and going to the tomb, rolled back the stone and sat on it. His appearance was like that of lightning, and his clothes were white as snow. The guards were so afraid of him that they shook and became like dead men. The angel said to the woman, "Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is not here. He is risen, just as he said. Come and see the place where he lay. Then go quickly and tell his disciples. He has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. Now I have told you." So the women hurried away from the tomb, afraid yet filled with joy. And they ran to tell the disciples. Suddenly Jesus met them. "Greetings," he said. They came to him. They clasped his feet and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, "Do not be afraid. Go and tell my brothers and go to Galilee. There they will see me." While the women were on their way, some of the guards went into the city and reported to the chief priests everything that had happened. When the chief priests had met with the elders and devised a plan, they gave the soldiers a large sum of money, telling them, "You are to say, his disciples came during the night and stole him away while we were asleep. If this report gets to the governor, we will satisfy him and keep you out of trouble." So the soldiers took the money and did as they were instructed. And this story has been widely circulated among the Jews to this very day. Then the 11 disciples went to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to go. When they saw him, they worshiped him, but some doubted. Then Jesus came to them and said, "All authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely, I am with you always, to the very end of the age." Amen. Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. I'm glad you're all here this morning. And sorry, some of you I only get you on Christmas and Easter, so I'm going to get you. Well, listen up. We got a good message for you. It's one that we all need to hear. And, you know, when you look around today, I look around, I see how much we live in a society where everybody wants to be kept up to date. Everything needs to be up to date. We need the latest app. We need the latest iPhone. We need information, up-to-date news, up-to-date software. We're bombarded by breaking news 24/7. And yet, sadly, in the midst of wanting all this updatedness, we have a tendency to live in this updated world with a yesterday mindset. So many people still have a yesterday mindset. There are times when you could say that we are not working with the most up-to-date approach in our daily life. There's times when we make choices. We make choices that affect our lives and the lives of others that aren't based on the most recent information that's available. Now, if you make a health decision or a financial decision or a business decision that's based on outdated material or information, it certainly is going to work against you. There's no doubt about it. But much worse is that we do the same thing with our spiritual lives. We have a new covenant with God through his Son, Jesus Christ. But we sometimes live as if the old covenant is still in place. Jesus Christ came into this world to make a difference in the way we live. and in the way that we relate to God and the way we relate to one another. But sometimes we're guilty of living as if He hasn't been here at all. Or as if what He accomplished during His time on earth didn't matter. We live in a new covenant reality with an old covenant approach. We live in today's world with a yesterday mindset. And so I want to tell you about an event that took place in the life of Jesus. An event that can be described as the ultimate "This Changes Everything" event. Because that's the title today. This Changes Everything. It's an event that changed so much. So it's Easter Sunday. We're gathered here. You know why we're here. And you can guess what that event is that I'm talking about, probably, since there's a life-size tomb behind me that might give you a clue. It's the story upon what this church and every church is built. Here's how the story goes. You heard a little bit of it. I want to recount it just so you don't miss it, because we're going to glean some really good, important stuff today out of this. Toward the end of Jesus' ministry on earth, He had come to be seen more and more as a threat to the religious establishment, the people that controlled things. And He was becoming a nuisance to the political establishment as well. So the leaders from both groups, they got together and they co-conspired to make an example of this rabble-rousing rabbi that's going around stirring everything up. They chose a time when Jerusalem would be filled with the most people. They arranged to have him arrested. They put him to a mockery in the trial. They sentenced him to death. And then he was publicly executed on the outskirts of town on a hill called Mount Calvary. At this point, people in power said they thought that was that. His followers surely would disperse. And it would be the last that they would hear of this carpenter that claimed to be a king. And they were almost right. Because you know what happened? The disciples, for the most part, also thought that was that when they saw Jesus crucified. After he was arrested, all of them, except for one, abandoned Jesus and ran for their lives. One of them, who had earlier sold out Jesus for some pieces of silver, he ultimately took his own life. Another one, who had days before promised to be faithful to Jesus to the end. But instead, he denied him right in the public square, calling down curses, saying, "I never even knew that man." So those in power, right, they were correct in a way, thinking that the disciples would disappear in the night and just go away. Only one disciple, John, and a few women stayed with Jesus to the bitter end. And together they watched from a distance his humiliating death, naked, forsaken, and alone. Their hearts were broken because they were sure the dream was over. Later that evening, after his spirit left his body, those few remaining faithful followers took his corpse and placed it in a tomb. And that appeared to be that. But there's something that those people in power didn't consider. On Sunday morning, well, you know what happened next. We read the text a little earlier, and you've heard the story all your life. On Sunday morning, some women came to the tomb to anoint Jesus' body with oil, which was an ancient custom to keep him from decomposing for as long as possible. And now, since Jesus was such a notorious character, and his death had been so high profile in the city, the stone that sealed the tomb was guarded by Roman soldiers, just to make sure that some crazies didn't come along and steal his body and make some kind of claim that he had come back from the dead or something. So while the guards are watching the tomb, and while the women are on their way, the ground begins to shake and tremble, and when they arrive at the tomb, the guards are still there, but they're terrified. The stone has already been moved away. And there was an angel dressed in white, dazzling white, sitting there. And he said to the women, listen, this is what the angel said, do not be afraid any longer. The one you are looking for isn't here. He is risen. Go quickly now and tell the other disciples that Jesus Christ is no longer dead. As the women hurried away, still afraid, but beginning to experience an awakening of tremendous joy inside at the same time, they came face to face with the risen Son of God. Imagine what that was like. And what did they do when they saw him? They fell at his feet and worshiped him. And he said to them, do not be afraid any longer, but go and tell my brothers I am alive. Tell them to go to Galilee and I will meet them there. These brothers he referred to, these disciples, found their way to the Mount of Galilee, and there they met him face to face, the risen Son of God, face to face. And what did the disciples do when they saw him? They worshiped him. And then he gave them what's called the Great Commission. Do you know what that is? It's the mission statement of this church and every United Methodist church. He said in verse 18, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Verse 20, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age. This is how the book of Matthew ends. So I don't know what the disciples said next, but here I'll tell you what I suspect they said. I said, looked around and said, hey guys, this changes everything. We thought he was dead, he's alive. I'm here today to tell you that the resurrection of Jesus Christ turns that old way of living into a new approach, completely upside down. It turns our old, stuck in that old traditional way upside down. Jesus is calling us to something else. Because of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, your life no longer has to be what it might have been before. You are no longer bound by yesterday's news or yesterday's information. That's because today there is a new story, and the new story changes everything. So today I want to take a couple minutes to look at some of the details real quick in Matthew 28, because it shows how we should respond to the resurrection of Jesus Christ. What do we do now? This is what today's message is about. What now? Since Jesus is raised from the dead, yeah, we know that, we get that. What does it mean? What am I supposed to do now? The ramifications of the resurrection of Christ are too many to name in a single sermon. However, today I want to look at three ways we respond to the resurrection of Christ. These three reactions will put us on the path to a this changes everything approach to life. First of all, in light of the resurrection of Jesus Christ, you need to let go of yesterday's fears. When the women went to the tomb, and they saw the stone moved and the angel sitting there, what did he say to them? What did he say? He said, do not be afraid. The literal translation in the Greek is stop being afraid. Later, when they met Jesus along the way, he spoke to them using the very same phrase, stop being afraid. I don't think that the fear the women in this story were experiencing, the fear that the angel and Jesus were referring to, was a brand new, in the moment kind of fear. It wasn't because of the earthquake and the stone rolled away that they were scared. Both the angel and the risen Lord were referring to the fear that had most certainly consumed these women, consumed them, as well as the followers of Jesus, for the past few days. It was an unrelenting fear, a fear that had caused a majority of them to run and hide. The very first message on Easter morning, and they heard it twice, was this. You can stop being afraid now. Jesus would say the same thing to you today. You can stop being afraid. What do we fear, you and me? What do we fear? I would say that the fears we face are almost all but identical to the fears that the disciples faced during that dreadful weekend. Like the disciple, we feel perhaps that we fear that the dream is over. We fear that we're facing battles that ultimately God can't even win. Battles that the bad guys are bound to win, and sin is eventually going to win. We fear that we're alone in this world, vulnerable, unprotected. And we fear that we just might be next in line for the enemy's attack. And then what will we do? Huh? Do you know what causes us to feel afraid? It's when we think that Jesus is still in the tomb. And the best that we can hope for is to anoint his dead body with oil and think about what might have been. But I want to tell you something. He is no longer in the tomb. Okay? It is empty. The tomb is empty. Up from the grave he arose. And now we can sing that song, Christ the Lord has risen today. And if he can conquer death and sin and the grave, then he can help you to conquer your puny little problems. That's why the angel said, stop being afraid. That's why Jesus said, stop being afraid. And just like the angels told the women to come and see where he lay, we need to take a long, hard look at the grave that no longer holds him. And we need to give serious consideration to what that empty tomb stands for. What does it mean? If Jesus can conquer death, why in the world should we be afraid? Fear is yesterday's story. It's yesterday's strategy for living. There is a new story that is making the rounds. And here it is. Jesus Christ is alive, and you can let go of your fears. And that brings me to the second response that we need in a what now attitude. Instead of giving in to your fear, here's what you need to do. You need to give in to Jesus and give him the worship that he deserves. In church, we talk a lot about obeying Jesus and following Jesus and trusting Jesus and praying in Jesus' name and asking Jesus to work his wonders among us. And we need to make sure that in the midst of all this, that we are worshiping Jesus the way he deserves to be worshiped. What was the response when the women encountered Jesus on the way? How did they respond? They came to him, clasped his feet, and worshiped him. What was the response of the disciples when they met Jesus on the mountain in Galilee? When they saw him, they, what? Worshiped him. Why would we worship Jesus? Why? Why? Because he is God Almighty. He is God in the flesh. And he is worthy to be praised, worthy to be worshiped, and certainly worthy to be adored. Now I want you to notice something. The Bible says that when the disciples came to Galilee and saw Jesus, they worshiped him. And then Matthew adds this phrase in verse 17. But some doubted. That doesn't just refer to doubting Thomas. Some is plural, more than one. And we need to keep in mind that there's always going to be those who just don't quite get it, even when the truth is staring them right in the face. I also want you to notice what happened with those Roman guards. Matthew tells us that after the earthquake and after the angel and their fear subsided just a little, they took a bribe from the religious leaders, and they fabricated a story that none of this really happened. We need to keep in mind that there will always be those who have their own self-interest in mind who will deny the truth, even when it's right in front of them. Here's what I'm saying. Don't let yourself be sidetracked by those who don't get it and those who refuse to accept it. Pay them no mind. Instead, worship Jesus the way he deserves to be worshiped. And I also want to say that you, if you personally, if you have doubts about the resurrection, then you need to do what the angel said. You need to go back to the empty tomb, and you need to look where he lay. Examine the evidence of the resurrection for Jesus Christ. There is a ton of it out there. Some of it archaeological. There's a ton of it. And settle in your mind, once and for all, who Jesus is and whether or not he is who he claimed to be. And if he did, in fact, do what he said he would do. Settle that for yourself. Do some research. Look at the tomb. Just about every religion on this planet will tell you that Jesus was a good man. He was a good teacher. Even most skeptics and atheists will say that, well, they don't think much of organized religion. They agree that Jesus was a good man. He was an awesome teacher. And they might have a point. If his bones had ultimately turned to dust in that mid-eastern grave. But that's not what happened. Death could not hold him. He rose again. For those who want to say that he was just a good moral teacher, the resurrection of Jesus changes everything. He was not merely a teacher. He was not merely a man. He was King of Kings, Lord of Lords, and he alone is worthy of our praise. When things take place in your life that you just don't seem to understand, when you face circumstances over which you seem to have no control, instead of surrendering to fear, make this your what now response. Worship Jesus as the King of all kings. And instead of bowing in submission to the fear that you may feel, bow your knee to the one who was raised from the dead on Easter Day. And you will see a difference. In the final words that he spoke to his followers, he said in verse 18, "All authority in heaven and earth has been given to me." Other translations say, not all authority, but all power in heaven and earth has been given to me. And the Greek translation for the English actually needs both words. Both words to fully describe what it's all about. He has all the power. He has all the authority in all the world. He is Lord of Lords. And what better reason would you have to worship him than that? That should be enough. And worship him as that. As that. And that leads to the third thing I want to say, what now response that I ask you to consider this Easter Sunday. You need to live every day as if he is with you all the way, because he is. We feel that fear, and we feel it because we feel that we are alone. Lonely, unprotected, as I said. He wants you to know you are not alone. You are not alone, and you will never be alone. He is right here with you, and this is his promise. Listen, in verse 20, "And surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." And I want to emphasize that he's not with you. He's not with you as some helpless but sympathetic friend. He is with you as the one who has been given all authority and all power in heaven and earth. He is King of Kings, and he is going to be with you every step of the way. Does his presence in your life mean that everything is going to be a picnic? Your life is going to just be easy? No. It means instead your life is going to be manageable, and it is about to become a victory. There will be plenty of struggles, plenty of battles for you to face along the way. His followers faced many after his death for years. after the resurrection even, they face battles and struggles. But I want you to know that you will never face them alone. You need never face any problem without resurrection power. Ever. Never. The promise he gave to his followers comes to this. Listen, you receive the power you need for daily living as you walk daily in his presence. All authority has been given to him. He is here for you. He is right by your side. He is with you always until the very end of time. You don't need to look for him. You only need to look to him. Because he is already here. A Christian who lives in fear is like a doctor who's never heard of an antibiotic. And a Christian who faces life alone is like some kind of journalist that thinks Bill Clinton is still president. And a Christian who doesn't walk in resurrection power of Jesus Christ is like a computer programmer who has no idea of what the internet is. In other words, you're living your life based on old news and outdated information. And there is a new headline for you today, and I hope you hear it. Breaking news, folks. This just in. Jesus Christ is alive. He is risen from the dead. And he is Lord. And he is here right now. And he is with you every step of the way. There is nothing that he cannot do. No problem he cannot see you through. Because why? Because he is Lord. The power you need for daily living, you will receive when you walk daily in his presence. Promise. So say goodbye to fear. Goodbye, fear. Fall on your knees and worship the Lord Jesus. And let him fill your life today, because he so desperately wants to, with that resurrection power that you so desperately need. Amen? Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for showing us that you are with us and showing us how much you love us, paralyze us, that consume our thoughts and our energy and our time and cause us to miss the blessings that are right before us. We thank you, Jesus, for walking with us and being with us forever. Thank you for your peace and your strength, for your gift of eternal life. It's in your precious name we pray. Amen.